in targeting an audience that listens to what you say. Learn more about this exciting radio broadcasting opportunity by calling WNZK Radio at 248-557-3500. Call now. This is WNZK, Dearborn Heights, Detroit. Your ethnic superstation at 690 days, 680 nights.
أهلا بكل الذين انضموا للاستماع إلى راديو بلدي، أول راديو عربي أمريكي ويعنى بقضايا العرب في المهجر. برامجنا في راديو بلدي كل يوم جمعة من 8 وحتى 9 صباحا مع ليلى الحسيني في بث حي ومباشر عبر WNZK Radio 690 AM. صباح الخير بلدي، صباح الخير لكل مستمعينا.
Welcome to Radio Baladi, the first Arab, Middle Eastern and American simulcast radio show. Radio Baladi is broadcast every Friday morning on WNZK 690 AM from 8 until 9 Eastern Time on Good Morning Michigan with Layla Al-Husseini. Our call-in number, 248-557-3300. And now, stay tuned for the best radio talk show on Arab and American issues with your host, Layla Al-Husseini.
Good morning and welcome to Radio Baladi, the best and most effective ethnic radio in North America. You are the best of listeners. My name is KHalil Hachem and I'm your host today. I'm the executive editor of yamichigan.com, one of the fastest growing multimedia news in the Arab American and Middle Eastern community in Michigan. Again, I want to say thank you for joining us today. This is a beautiful morning. It's a little bit cold. However, they told us that it's going to be sunny later on, and it's going to warm up. This is going to be a great day, and it's going to be a great weekend as well. It's a holiday weekend. We wish all the communities happy Easter as well. Today, with us, we have a really great program for you today. Neda is with us, Neda Bakri, and Rafat is with us from Greece. What's Rafat's last name?
Al-Hamoud.
He's from Greece. We're going to be talking about the plight of Syrian refugees arriving to Greece later on. After that, we will be talking to Dr. Nesreen Suwan. She'll be talking to us about the effect of divorce on older children. In the news, first, there is a flood warning in the area. We got a lot of rain in the past couple of days, and the authorities have issued a flood warning. So if you've had any water in your basement in the past, keep an eye on it. There may be some flood or flash flood or some kind of a flood or backup. So be careful. Hopefully nothing will happen. In the news as well, a group of entrepreneurs in the community received awards for doing wonderfully, and we're proud of everyone in our community who is doing well and who is an entrepreneur and successful, and we hope that everybody else will be successful as well. Our thoughts and prayers continues with the victims and their families of the Brussels bombing. That was a horrible, horrible event, and we hope that the authorities there pursue and find those who are responsible and their supporters and bring him to justice. We hope that there'll be a day when we don't have to worry about crimes like that. We've had enough, and I think we need to really stop. Again, with us is Neda today, and we're waiting to hear from Rafat on the phone from Greece. Neda, am I saying your name correctly? Is it Neda?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
Very good, thank you.
Wonderful. Tell us a little bit about you, please.
My name is Neda Kadri. I'm from Dearborn, Michigan. I've been an activist, and I'm a marketing professional as well as PR professional. I write web content for nonprofits, so I've always been involved in charity work in one capacity or the next. And I traveled to Greece in December.
When did you travel? Yeah.
I traveled back in December.
Mm-hmm.
I went there after Rafat and I met in October, and we met while I searched for his family who had been on a big boat sinking that caught actually a lot of media attention back
so
in October.
Rafat is a Syrian refugee himself?
He is. He's a Syrian refugee himself. He took the trip about 2 years ago through Libya, though, which was a lot more difficult and a lot more countries to pass through. Couple years after, his family began, you know, different members of his family began to take the trip from Turkey to Greece, and in October, his cousin, along with her husband and four kids, were involved in a ship sinking, and only two of the children were rescued. The rest
What area was the ship sinking?
It was in the north end of Lesbos. Back then, the traffic was mostly to the... It was the same island we work on, but we work now on the south
coast. That's near Greece, is that correct?
It's a Greek island, but it's its own island, and it's closer to Turkey. It's about two hours away from Turkey.
Okay. So, and how did you meet?
We met through Facebook activism groups. He was searching for his family. I helped him search through my online network, and we found them about 2 days later. They had perished, four of them, four of the six had perished, and that's when Rafat traveled to Greece. He did so just to bury his family, but back then there was a little bit of an issue with the cemetery available. And so he was there for 3 weeks while they waited for a plot of land, and he volunteered during that time. And it was those pictures and those videos and those stories that really motivated me to travel myself, and I was there by December.
So basically you've seen, you heard the story, you've seen these videos through when you're here, and this is when you really decided you wanted to go there and help.
Right.
And what is it you help them there? Or before I ask you that, you know, tell us a little bit. I mean, we're so far from it. We just hear it's and pieces stories. What is the conditions there?
I mean, it depends on if you're asking when I first got there in December or how it was a month ago or how it is today. The conditions on the coast pretty much stay constant. You see an orange dot out on the horizon, and then you see that orange dot is actually a bunch of life vests when you look through the binoculars. And you have a bunch of volunteers just waiting to get ready. Sometimes we have to swim out to the boats, depending. That's Rafat's specialty right there, is swimming out to the boats that, for one reason or another, have a disabled motor. And you take in the boats, and on the coast, it's actually a very, very uplifting scene, as chaotic as it gets, and it does get really chaotic. You know, once people arrive, once everybody's in warm clothes, once they're getting on the buses to go to the camp, it's a joyous occasion. Now, back in December, walking through the camps, I would have told you there were awful conditions because people were waiting 4 or 5 days in the registration lines, and it was freezing cold, and they were outside. So I would have told you it's completely horrible. A month ago, I would have told you it's not so bad. The weather started to get a little better. People were getting their papers within hours. It was ideal. Today, I would tell you that the camp has closed to a closed detention facility because of the EU deal.
What's the EU deal?
The EU deal that would deport illegal migrants back to Turkey.
Okay.
So now they're considered detainees.
Okay.
Versus the camp a month ago, which was a free movement camp. They could come and leave.
What do you think? What contributed to that?
I mean...
Is it politics or is it...
It's definitely politics. I think there was a little bit of a push from citizens. There's a lot of rhetoric going on right now, anti-refugee rhetoric. And a lot of people are... You know, they say, well, we don't know who can sneak in, and, you know, they want to collectively punish all these people that are fleeing war. And so there is a little bit of a push from citizens, but there also is a lot of politics playing. You have Turkey trying to get into the EU and trying to lift visa restrictions for its citizens, and the EU wanting to put some kind of control over the refugee flow.
Sure. So let's set the scene. These are refugees are coming from where? They're fleeing Syria to Turkey.
Right.
And then they're getting on small boats from what I've seen in the videos. There's really small, small boats.
Very small.
And the water in that area is very choppy, very dangerous.
It is.
Some of them don't make it, some of them make it, and if they make it, they, you know, how do they arrive? I mean, are they sick? Are they tired? How many days have they been in the water?
Thankfully, it's worst case scenario, it's a 4 or 5 hour trip. Best case scenario, it's an hour and a half. It is quite scary because when you're in the raft, even when they're at
How big is the raft?
It's made to fit maybe 20, 25 people, and it's definitely not made for the sea.
No.
All they have on the back of
these are like, they look like a safety raft. Not really, you know.
I can't even describe them. They're very flimsy rubber.
Yeah.
And all they have in the back where the motor is blocking them from the waves is a 2-inch, maybe, piece of plywood.
Okay.
Something that you wouldn't even use, I don't know, on a home improvement project. So, and they're pretty high waves out there in the sea.
Mm-hmm.
Some do arrive where they're practically, it looks like they're floating on water. They've barely made it.
Mm-hmm.
We have had situations where people that are in the bottom of the raft, if they're laid down or whatnot, have suffocated because they drowned. Mm-hmm. I attended...
How many people in the raft? Like, they look like they're packed.
The least we've seen is 50.
Wow.
And the most we've seen is about 70 or 75.
Yeah.
And when we see 70 or 75, they've made a 3-story boat out of a little flimsy 25-person raft.
Mm-hmm. Who owns these rafts? Like people ferrying people in for a price?
No, they find the poorest guy on the raft and they give it to him for free. And sometimes they're inexperienced drivers.
Who gives it to them?
Smugglers.
Okay.
You know, smugglers.
Okay.
It's the smugglers that operate these rafts.
Okay.
If you think about going and buying your own, they also have pirates out on the sea. If you think about getting a group together and buying your own for $2,000, because it's about $1,000 a head, sometimes $1,200, $1,500, depending.
A person.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Depending on the season. In the winter, they did discounts.
Yeah.
Because the water was so choppy.
Yeah.
Because it's a business to them. It's not.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
And if you think about buying your own raft, you're not going to make it. One way or another, you're not going to make it. You're going to be pirated or sent back, or you're not going to make it.
Yeah, that's a very bleak situation. So when they arrive, what is their condition?
It depends on the kind of trip that they had. If they had an hour and a half trip, they come out joyous and happy and see, we told you there wasn't going to be any problems and whatnot. If they had a 5-hour trip, sometimes they have mental breakdowns right as they're getting off the boat. The moment their feet hit the soil and they realize they're okay is when they completely lose it.
Yeah.
Crying, cold, hypothermic, in shock.
The children, how many of them normally they're sick? I mean, adults can take things like that, but I mean, children must be really tough on them.
It's actually, if you're talking mentally,
yeah,
it's actually the opposite because the children aren't old enough to process what they're experiencing.
Okay.
So they only get scared when the adults mm-hmm. get scared and mm-hmm. start screaming, and they realize that they're in danger because everybody around them is screaming and mom and dad is going crazy.
Okay.
That's from a mental aspect. Now, if you're talking from a physical aspect, yes, their little bodies are more tender, more susceptible to cold.
Yeah.
So their bodies physically can't handle what the adults can.
So you retrieve these guys and you take them off these boats, and what do? You process them? I mean, what happens next?
Well, as volunteers, our job on the coast is we hand out water, we hand out snacks, we hand out juice. Some of them have low blood sugar and whatnot,
mm-hmm.
so
mm-hmm.
We make sure they have new socks, dry shoes. We wrap them in blankets.
Who provides that?
Donations
and...
Humanitarian. Certain sponsorships. We all fundraise. They're all private fundraisers, private donations. The most that we've ever gotten as far as, like, groups donating is we had the SURF Fund, the Syrian United Relief Fund from California, sponsor a project for us, a caravan that we sent out to Idomeni with 5 vans, including an ambulance. So... beyond that, it's private fundraising. You just appeal to people and say, please, you know, we need to provide these things, and they're not for free.
How many volunteers are there?
At this point, there are many, and you have many different smaller NGOs there. But there's a lot of work to be done on the island, and many of the NGOs can only volunteer at a certain capacity, and that's where the independent volunteers like us come into play, because
mm-hmm,
we have no restrictions.
Mm-hmm.
So we can be on the coast at night, in the camp, pulling a vulnerable family out and putting them up in a hotel so that they don't spend the night in the camp.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
An hour later, an hour after that, we're at a travel agent booking tickets for people. An hour after that, we've taken a group of refugees out to lunch. So independent volunteers like us can kind of do what they want when they want.
Sure, sure. And now, this island is the first contact or the first place where refugees come to. And after
right.
that, they go to different places in Europe. Is that, they don't stay in Greece. They don't stay on that island.
No, for the most part, people don't apply for asylum in Greece because Greece does have its own economic issues and can't offer them okay. the services other countries do. Yes, Lesbos would be the first stop, and then they ferry over on a 12-hour, but it's a huge ferry, to Athens.
Mm-hmm.
They're processed some more, and then they jump on a bus, and they're taken to, Idomeni, which is at the Macedonian border.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, they continue on their journey. They have to go through countries like Serbia and Slovenia and Croatia.
Do people have in mind where they're going when they arrive to the island?
For the most part, yeah, at this point, everybody knows a friend or a family member or a husband, you know, that's been somewhere,
mm-hmm,
and they're
mm-hmm,
trying to go
mm-hmm.
to that place.
Mm-hmm.
This point in it, everybody just says Almania, you know, because
they know that Germany
is the only place that's going to take them.
Yeah, yeah. What we're going to do is we're going to take a short break, and we'll be right back with Neda Kadri. We're talking about the Syrian refugee plight in Greece as they arrive there. Please stay tuned.
From their first words to first grade, Dreamy Children's Center will help get your child on the right track. The highly qualified staff works closely with parents to provide an experience that goes beyond early education. We can help nurture important personality traits with the use of educational programs ranging from preschooling for infants to Montessori-approved programs and bilingual curriculums for young children. All meals can be provided, and we can arrange for after-school pickup. Dreamy Children's Center in Dearborn Heights on Warren, in Westland on Ann Arbor Trail, and in Troy on DeQuinder.
Jumana Kairouz. You've seen her images on giant billboards across the metro. Jumana Kairouz. You've seen her images on buses across the city. Now get to know Jumana Kairouz.
Most people who sit in my office across from my desk are hurting on so, so many levels. One thing people do not know about medical malpractice is that the statute of limitation, meaning the time that you have to bring suit against a doctor, a hospital, is 2 years. In medical malpractice, that's a very, very short period of time. Not every lawyer is an advocate, but every lawyer should be an advocate.
Let Jumana Kairouz protect your rights. Call the law offices of Jumana Kairouz at 1-866-YOUR-RIGHTS, extension 100, or visit yourrights.com.
Ziad Brand. Quality products from our family to yours. Ziad Brothers Importing offers the finest quality products, including brands like Sultan, Kraft, Nestle, Hook, Rico Picon, Donna, and many more. Ask your retailer to carry these fine products, because you deserve the very best. For more information, visit our website at www.ziad.com. That's www.ziad.com. Ziad, quality products from our family to yours.
Nidal's Pharmacy is a place to go for all of your prescription needs. All insurance plans are accepted at Nidal's Pharmacy. Prescription delivery is available. Nidal's Pharmacy is located at 23,800 Orchard Lake Road, Suite 102 in Farmington Hills. Call 248-477-2131. Nidal's Pharmacy, 248-477-2131.
Welcome back, and thank you for tuning in. We're talking to Neda Kadri and Rafat from Greece. Good morning. Tell us who Rafat is and what he's doing there, بالعربي.
Rafat هو الشريك, partner. أنا ويا التيم الواحد. عم نشتغل مع بعض, وهو هلأ مارس, يعني بعده مش مستمر بالشغل. هو باليونان هلأ.
You know, basically, Rafat is in Greece, and we've been trying to connect with him on Skype, and, you know, Rafat speaks Arabic. He doesn't speak English. Is that correct?
He does speak English, but we're the Arabic-English duo. I do the English, and he does the Arabic.
Yeah. He's more proficient with Arabic.
Yeah.
I can see where this is really, you know, a good partnership there, trying to serve this really incredible cause. We will get back as Rafat connects with us. Where do you guys stay? I mean, how do you cope with this?
We do have each apartment. You can't do the hotel life when you're there for 3 months.
Yeah.
Coping wise, we've really come to learn to lean on each other.
Yeah.
And that's why our partnership and our team is such a good team. Mm-hmm. You find a way. You have to cope or you can't do the job. And you find a way.
So who pays for those apartments? Do you personally or fundraising or what?
Initially, we had both worked and saved up everything and were paying cash out of pocket, which covered the first portion of my trip. And budget was a little bit of an issue because you're not making any money. You're just spending there. Sure. And so afterwards, I did get a couple private sponsorships, people that wanted me to remain in Greece and continue doing my work. So sent X amount of money to cover that. It was the case with both of us.
You're basically first responders. I mean, you're there, you're pulling them out of the water and helping them to get, you know, to where they need to get some help, and finally that they reached Europe, and then they're there ferried into Greece. And what do you want? I mean, what if you have people sick or dead, or what happened to them?
We're more than first responders. Sometimes we're the rescuers as well.
Sure, sure.
First responders, second responders, social workers.
Yeah.
So we're many things. You know, Rafat had a death a couple of days ago right along the coast.
What was it?
The man was on an overcrowded dinghy. I'm not sure if he suffocated or what happened, but he arrived unconscious and unresponsive to the beach. They attempted to resuscitate him. They couldn't. He ended up passing away. And during all of this, Rafat is holding his young toddler. Okay. And he had pulled her off the boat, and when he asked her, "Where is your father?" And she said, "He's sleeping."
Oh,
and
my God.
That's when they discovered that he was unconscious.
Dead. Yeah, yeah.
And so in this scenario right here,
how old was he?
The man, he was in his 40s.
In his 40s, yeah.
Right.
And the children?
The one that I saw was a toddler. He had two more with him. I'm not sure their ages. Okay. Rafat would know.
How do you explain that to a toddler? Was there a mother there?
Their mother was hysterical. She was outside the car. You don't. Yeah. In Rafat's case, you know, I was on the phone with him. He just got her warm. And he just tried to talk to her about just normal things you would talk to, because she looked shocked. She was in shock. So you don't. That job, thankfully, for the most part, we try to avoid it falling on us. There are designated social workers with different organizations that handle stuff like
Each
that.
Each person has a role to really perform, is that correct?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
In your case, it seems like you guys do more than what you expect to do.
Yeah, we do everything. Some days we're at the port giving stuff out. Some days we're traveling to the border to hand stuff out. Like I said, Rafat swims out to the boats. He swam out a couple hundred meters to swim in a boat. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes we're addressing cold people. We play many, many roles in many different capacities.
Sure, sure. How could people help?
For the most part, you know, the help is two parts. I hate to be so blunt about it, but it's the truth. Donations, donations, donations.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Because, yes, we're on the ground and we're working hard, and we have this saying, this joke that we say, you know, yesterday, that's tomorrow, that's today, you know, مبارح اللي هو بكرة اللي هو اليوم.
Yeah, yeah.
And we say that because some days we start at 9 p.m. and we're working until 3 a.m. A full 36 hours later.
Yeah.
So we're willing and we'll do the work, but we can't do it if we don't have things to give out, or if we don't have those. We can't arrive to a people that need help with a van full of stuff if we can't afford the van that's full of stuff.
Absolutely.
So we absolutely, it's so vital. We need the support of everybody that's around. And
even a little amount can go a long way, you know. I mean, this is something. I mean, it may be a few dollars to us, but over there can mean a lot.
Yeah.
Can mean a life to someone.
It really can.
So, I mean, aside from politics, aside from the fact who's on what side, this is a humanitarian issue.
Precisely. We don't, when we run to Iraq, just swim to Iraq, we don't ask, are you Afghani, are you Kurd, are you Yazidi,
exactly.
Are you Syrian, are you Eritrean, are you from the Congo? And these are all people that we've personally helped and worked with.
Exactly.
We never ask that. When we get a call from a travel agent saying There's a family in here begging for help. We don't ask where are they from.
Exactly. What religion?
Nothing.
And that
we
is really
care.
The true work.
Yeah, we don't
this
care.
This is what people really need to know. You know, we hope our listeners are motivated by this humanitarian aspect of it. Not, you know, it doesn't matter what political side you're on or what sectarian side you're on. Look at it from a humanitarian, you know, aspect and it just, you know, heartbroken to really hear about all these children and the plight of people. I lived in a war zone and I know what it means to flee from death. And, you know, and then when you leave your country, this is something not easy, you know.
Right.
You don't know. You're going to the unknown. You have no idea what's going to happen. So, if people are going to donate, how would they donate? Who would they donate to?
We have two ways to donate. I have a GoFundMe going.
Okay.
Called Help Vulnerable Refugees in Greece. It's okay. Under my name, Neda Kadri. You also can, there's some people that don't like to go through GoFundMe, so they can donate through my PayPal,
mm-hmm.
Which is nedakadri@gmail.com.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So there's a couple ways to donate for now. We are officially forming an organization,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Humans for Humanity,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we're doing so because now the situation has changed.
Sure.
And you need to be able to access.
And also there are a lot of other organizations that are helping, so if you provide any help you can through any mean that you're comfortable with, as long as
I agree. Although I have to say this, and the bigger organizations are doing great things, I won't take that from them, but there are times where a bigger organization will show up to a camp of 5,000 people with 1,000 parcels of food. The other 4,000 fall back on independent volunteers like us.
Sure, sure.
So while I commend people that donate to the bigger organizations, I have to say, please start donating to the smaller folks. If not us, another group, that's fine, because we're the ones filling in the void, and we don't get big funding from government.
Sure, sure,
we don't
sure.
get grants.
Sure, sure.
You know, sometimes we're spending from our own penny sleeping, you know, in the most squalid ways just to be able to do this. And,
sure,
you know.
Sure. I was looking at some of the videos, and there was a woman with cancer. What was that issue?
Her son is the one that had cancer,
okay,
in Germany.
The son, okay.
And she was stuck at the Thessaloniki close to the border,
mm-hmm.
about an hour from the border. And that's when they closed the borders, and they told her there was no hope of going out, and the family reunification process would take minimum 4 months. Rafat and I worked on a couple videos,
mm-hmm.
and a couple social media contacts,
mm-hmm.
and we were able to get The Independent to run an article, which caught the attention of the Prime Minister of Greece, who spoke about it with Prime Chancellor Merkel at the EU summit, ironically enough, the same one that stopped the flow of refugees. And we were able to get the family reunited yesterday.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful.
Yeah, they're now in Germany.
Yeah, that's wonderful.
Which was
now,
amazing.
Are you Syrian?
I am. My mother's Syrian, and my father's Palestinian.
Okay.
And Rafat is full-blown Syrian.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And, this must be, like, how often do you go back and forth?
I will be back April 6th. This is my first stateside visit.
Mm-hmm.
For now, I'm going indefinitely. I don't know when I'll return.
Okay. So your family here, or is just, you know, you don't
Yeah,
have
my
to...
entire family's here.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Sounds good. And, how does your family feel about your work?
They're very proud, thankfully. Mm-hmm. They do
mm-hmm.
support my work.
Mm-hmm.
They're very proud of the mission that
mm-hmm.
I've undertaken.
Mm-hmm.
And they're incredibly supportive.
Yeah, well, I'm sorry we couldn't really connect with Rafat because of the Skype is not reliable from there. And, you know.
It's okay. We'll bring him on another time.
Another time, yeah.
Yes.
Before we go, I just wanted you to tell us one more time, how can people help, how they can get in touch with you, and hopefully that you're going to make it into an official organization so people feel more comfortable donating. Sure, go ahead and tell us, please.
Sure. You can connect with me on Facebook, Neda, N-E-D-A, Kadri, K-A-D-R-I. If you'd like to donate via PayPal, it's the same thing, nedakadri@gmail.com. And links for my fundraiser are on my page. Please spread the word. Please keep refugees in your prayers. They need them. And please be mindful of this crisis. What we're witnessing on those islands are things that I wouldn't wish on my worst enemy to see in their nightmare. It's very hard, and they really, really need your love and your support in every single which way possible.
Well, thank you so much. I really want to thank you for being with us today. And again, you know, regardless of what politics you have, and this is a humanitarian issue, and any support can go a long way. Neda, we want to thank you for taking the time to be
thank
with us.
Thank you for having
and,
me.
And we're going to take a short break. We'll be right back.
Life for Relief and Development is a nonprofit charity that has been providing humanitarian aid and development to people and communities regardless of race, color, religion, or cultural background for over 22 years. When disaster occurs here or around the world, Life rushes to provide food, medical aid, and shelter to those in need. Life also has development projects that provide medical relief, water purification, educational programs, relief for orphans, and much more. Your help and support can greatly improve these efforts. All donations are tax deductible. For more information, please visit our website at lifeusa.org or call 248-424-7493. That's lifeusa.org, 248-424-7493.
Are you going to start a restaurant or a grocery store soon? Do you need floor plans and designs? Call Najee Abood at 734-744-9796. Do you want to buy kitchen and restaurant equipment at discount prices? Call Najee Abood now, 734-744-9796. New Concept Products and Design, the trademark of kitchen equipment. 5% discount on all purchases of $75,000 or more. New Concept Products and Design, new location, 31185 Schoolcraft in Livonia. Learn more at www.newconceptproducts.com. Call Najee Abood, 734-744-9796.
When you're looking for the best in optical care, Dr. Imad Nakash is your doctor to see. With years of experience and thousands of successful procedures performed, you can trust your eyes to Dr. Imad Nakash. See Dr. Imad Nakash and his professional staff for your eye care needs. There's two locations to serve you. In Hazel Park, call 248-336-3937. 248-336-3937. In Rochester Hills, call 248-299-3937. That's 248-299-3937.
Welcome back, and thank you for being with us this morning. We were talking to Neda Kadri, and we couldn't connect with Rafat. Maybe next time we will, is because of the technology has been good, but sometimes it doesn't really deliver what it needs to deliver. Anyway, Neda was talking about their work, their volunteer work on the island, in one of the islands near Greece, and what happened there is that they receive the refugees. And they're fleeing Turkey or other places, and you know they may be, from different backgrounds, and they receive them there, and they process them, and they help them, and then they, put on a ferry back to toward Athens, and then they start their new journey, finding a safe place to live. There is really in life there is nothing worse than the dilemma of what to do with your family if you're fleeing a devastating war and you start on a journey. You know, and in most cases you have a few dollars in your pocket and you want to do whatever you can to save your family and find a new life, find a new place to live, whether it is temporarily or, you know, as to immigrate to there. These are not easy decisions. And people traveling to the unknown, and this is what happens when they get to the island. And Neda and her crew and the rest of the volunteers are trying to really, help out these people. So, again, if regardless of what politics you follow and what group you like and dislike, this is a humanitarian issue. If you can help. There are many ways and to donate, to help, to support these refugees. And we hope that the war and factors get to a point to their senses and stop the war, because the best help for the refugees is to stop the bleeding, hopefully, soon, you know, and soon, pretty soon, today, tomorrow, whatever it is, they stop the fighting and people stop fleeing their homes, or they can return to their homes, because you know, being a refugee is not a. We fled our hometown in southern Lebanon in 79, and we lived in a different town for about 9 months, and that, you know, you miss. It's not just you're not on vacation. You know, you're a refugee. You're fleeing to an area. It's not, nothing feels right. And I was in the same country, so can you imagine being in a different country? You don't speak the language. Don't know what awaits you. So we urge you to support, and we pray that the war and factions will get to a point where, you know, go back to their senses and stop the fighting, stop the madness. And, you know, same thing what happened in Brussels as well. I mean, all that madness there. What are we getting out of that? You know, what's and I don't care who it is behind it. What are they getting out of that except the you know, murdering people and killing people? These are criminals. You know, there's no cause worthy of putting a bomb in a place where people are trying to board a plane. It's just horrible. You know, it just does not get any worse than that. And, you know, I hope that those who are encouraging people to do something like this, you know, find a way to just stop. Just don't. It's just maddening. You know, I try to think about it and think, you know, why would they do that? You know, and I guess madness doesn't have a logic. So we hope that the authorities will go after these criminals and those who support them financially, emotionally, in any way, you know, shape and fashion, to really stop that madness. And madness happens, and violence has no religion. So it's not one religion or the other. It's just it's a human action that is nothing but criminal. So we hope that stops. We are awaiting Dr. Suwan to join us. We're going to be talking about divorce and the effect of divorce on older children. You know, and this is the number of divorces continue to rise in our community, in every community, specifically in our community. And she wanted to tackle that issue, and I think it's a really great issue to tackle. In the few minutes we have, I just wanted to, you know, talk to you a little bit about the real estate market. It's getting hotter and hotter. You know, April is, spring is here, and normally early spring and early summer, this is when the market really gets really hot. If you have, and there is a great demand for good homes, and if you have, you know, you're thinking about selling or about, this is the perfect time to put it on the market. If you're thinking about buying, this is the perfect time to start looking, to start getting ready, to start getting pre-approved. You know, to buy a home, you have either to have cash, to buy it for cash, or you have to get a loan. And most of us don't have that kind of amount of cash on hand. So what we need, you know, what you need to do is, if you need to get a loan, what you need to do is you need to get pre-approved and find out how much home can you afford. And okay, we have Dr. Suwan on the line. Good morning, Dr. Suwan.
Good morning, Khalil.
How are you?
Yeah, I'm fine, thank you.
Wonderful, wonderful. Yeah, I was just giving a little note about if people are looking to buy a home, how they can get qualified and ready and or put their home on the market. If you have any questions about that, give me a call, 313-819-0101, or you can go to homesbykhalil.com. I'll be more than happy to work with you and help you with that. So have you been, Dr. Suwan?
Oh, I'm fine. As a matter of fact, it's really interesting that you are talking about building homes.
Yes. Now we need to talk about how we can maintain a home that was built and maintaining it from a different aspect, which is, you know, the effect of divorce on, or if possible, not to get the divorce, and the devastating effect on older children. So,
as a matter of fact, you know, it's a catastrophic effect, I would say.
Sure.
And it's really on older children, mm-hmm, as well as younger children. But mm-hmm, I want to focus on older children, because everybody thinks that if they are old, they are not affected.
Sure.
So people may think, okay, they are old, why do they care? As a matter of fact, maintaining family homes would be as important for older children or adult children as it is for younger children.
Absolutely.
I want to say that marriage matters for children, whatever age they are. This is a fact, and I would say that children of divorce struggle with their life, no matter, you know, if they are like 5 years old or even like 35 or 45 years old. I don't know if you agree with me or
absolutely,
not.
Absolutely. I mean, after all, they're humans and they're affected by emotions, and the destruction of family is not, you know, is not easy. So I do agree with you 100%.
So I would say that, you know, in a case of a divorce, and especially gray divorce, and I would say that the gray divorce, that it's the divorce that is happening, like, you know, in later stages of life,
okay,
there should be, of course, an offending agent. The
sure.
offending agent is the one who is initiating the divorce. And most likely, and from my work, you know, like in some organizations, and also, you know, from my work as a physician, and I hear, you know, like lots of stories from my patients, usually the offending agent is really the man.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And in most cases, it is because
That's in our community, is that correct?
Unfortunately,
unfortunately, okay.
And most likely it is related to betrayal and cheating. Now, it's not always the situation that the father or the husband will come and say, you know, I want, as a matter of fact, to cheat right now with another woman who's younger than, you know, like your mother, and, you know, I feel that, you know, I should actually start like a new life right now. Most of the situation, you know, most of cases, you know, the man will not say this, and he will start actually just leaving the family, and he will start, you know, like putting all kinds of lies together, you know, like to let his children and to convince himself as well that his life, like for 40 years or 30 years or 45 years, was not actually the life that he was looking for. And now he found the life. Most likely the life will be with a younger woman who mm-hmm, will be a gold digger, who's looking, you know, for a short cut, you know what I mean?
Exactly.
He doesn't have, for example, you know, like to struggle in life, you know, with somebody her age. So in this case, she will find just like, you know, an older man who can actually provide everything for her. She doesn't care if she's going to steal him from his wife or children or whatever. So basically, the man in a situation like this, he will lie and he would say, oh, I wasn't happy. Oh, I was sick of all of this life or something like that. Or he may not say anything and he would say, oh, it's my life and, you know, I am actually, you know, like free. I can do whatever I can. So basically, you know, like it's a very, very, very catastrophic situation.
Sure,
and
because it's the result. I mean, the result of what happened, the break down of the family and you know, the destruction of the home.
Exactly. Usually the offending agent, I would say, or the offending parent, would assume that the children are not hurt because, you know, they are adults. And a small matter like, you know, like breaking the family or maybe airing, you know, like dirty laundry or, you know, like exposing, you know, finances of the family in courts or selling the family home or anything like that, you know, nothing would matter for the children, you know, because they are adults. But as a matter of fact, it matters. Marriage matters for all children, whether they are old or
absolutely
or young.
Absolutely. So what kind of effect we're talking about?
So, you know, I would say most importantly, children, they lose their role model in their life.
Mm-hmm.
Whether they are young or whether they are adults, they will lose, you know, the role model. So, especially in gray divorces, I mean, you know, what's happening, you know, like is, you know, especially if it is related to cheating or betrayal, they really do not know. Are they supposed to have this father who left the family after like 45 years or 40 years or 30 years? Is he the role model? I mean, are they trying, you know, actually to have the same life as he's, you know, as he had? And are they going to do the same thing like what he did? And they will start asking, you know, like, do we really want to be like our mother who was left, like, you know, after 40 years or after 45 years? Or should we be like, you know, this gold digger who is a younger woman who's trying actually to run after an older man because, you know, he's wealthy? So basically the role model is totally, totally, totally lost.
Yeah. Yeah.
Unfortunately, this thing is not only affecting the children. I mean, you know, like in the community, you know, somebody would find that somebody else did that, so why not me?
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
Exactly. Yeah.
I don't know if you agree with me about this or not, but I would say that family values will be totally, totally gone, and the image of the family and the image of the marriage is gone.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I agree with you. I mean, it does affect, you know, the overall, and if we don't really say something about it and stand up to it, then we're approving it without saying anything.
Exactly. Yeah. As a matter of fact, and unfortunately, and I've heard it from some of my patients, when something like that is happening, you know, like people would actually be, you know, like silent about it, or, you know, some of them actually, if they are like, you know, if they are having an interest, you know, in any shape or form, they are going actually, you know, like to encourage it. Oh, you just go ahead, it's your life, do whatever you want. I mean, you know, this is really a huge problem because, you know, like people who are promoting this type of behavior, they do not know that they are basically breaking the image of the marriage, breaking the image of the, I would say, a holy relationship.
Absolutely.
That was established by all religions.
Absolutely. And what I want to do right now is take a short break, and then we're going to go back and talk about this even more. Please stay tuned.
قشات ميديترينيان ماركت بإدارة سهر قشات وأولاده يرحبون بالجالية العربية والكلدانية، جميع أنواع المواد الغذائية، ألبان طازجة، الكرزات والبهارات الطازجة. داخل الأسواق مطعم ميديترينيان شيش كباب يقدم يوميا جميع أنواع الكباب، المقبلات العربية العراقية وصواني الكامبو المميزة. تفتح الأسواق من 8 إلى 9 مساء من الاثنين وحتى السبت، ومن 8 صباحا إلى 9 مساء يوم الأحد. تقع الأسواق على 2839 North Western Highway في مدينة فارمينغتون هيلز. لحوم حلال للجالية الإسلامية. لطلباتكم من المطعم call 248-538-7855. That is 248-538-7855. قشة ميديترينيان ماركت، خدمة متميزة ومعاملة راقية.
أمسافر وحدك وفايتني.
أمتي ترافل للسياحة والسفر بإدارة نبيل الباشا تعلن عن افتتاح مكتبها الواقع على 28695 راين رود في مدينة وارن. خدمات متميزة وخبرة تفوق 20 عاما نضعها في خدمة عملائنا الكرام. مع أمتي ترافل يمكنكم حجز رحلاتكم الجوية داخل أمريكا، الوطن العربي وأنحاء العالم، إضافة إلى الأماكن السياحية والاستجمام. للحصول على أفضل العروض وأنسب الأسعار ولمزيد من المعلومات اتصلوا على الرقم 586-578-9126 586-578-9126. أمتي ترافل عنوان للصداقة والثقة. أسواق زمزم الواقع على 24065 أورشيد ليك في مدينة فارمينغتون هيلز ترحب بالجالية العربية والكلدانية. تنزيلات كبيرة على عموم المواد الغذائية في يوم الأربعاء من كل أسبوع. لا تنسوا فريش كاري اوت جميع انواع المعجنات وايضا صواني الكمبو المشكله والصمون الحار لحوم حلال الجاليه العربيه والاسلاميه الملحمه باداره قصاب الجاليه المعروف سلوان جربوع. زوروهم على 24065 اورشد ليك في مدينه فارمينغتون هاوس او اتصلوا بهم على 248-476-0300. اسواق زمزم للمذاقي عنوان لجميع طلباتكم اتصلوا على 248-476-0300. اسواق زمزم للمعامله الراقيه وكرم الضيافه عنوان.
Welcome back and thank you for being with us. We're talking to Dr. Suwan. We're talking about the effect of divorce on older children. And Dr. Suwan, what can these people do? I mean, if we can't save the marriage and whatever happens, happens, where can they find help?
You know, as a matter of fact, you know, I think that counseling may help, but, you know, I think that preventing this from happening is the most important thing.
I mean, you know,
the parent who would be very selfish, like, you know, if you know, like a man is running after another woman, you know, and he's going actually to sacrifice the whole, family for something like that. Or if a woman is doing this, you know, for her, you know, like children, because, you know, she's, for example, running after, you know, a wealthier man. I mean, this thing, I feel that, you know, in medicine and life, prevention is more important than, you know, like,
Absolutely. Yeah,
than treatment.
Absolutely.
I mean, you know, I would like actually, you know, like to add, you know, like some of the other effects that, you know, I have seen in so many of my patients who went through this. I would say that, you know, that children will be hurt by their parents' lack of commitment, whether it is the father or the mother. And they may carry this kind of brittle emotions, you know, to their future life. So this is one of the effects. The other effect that the children, whether they are young or old, and maybe it is even more in adult children, they will have an identity crisis because, you know, they are supposed to be connected to two disconnected people. And they have to be connected to two disconnected worlds, if you will. And often, they will actually choose the side of the mother and they will just, like, you know, stick with their mother. They may lose contact with the father completely. Because, you know, the father actually is, like, working so hard also to lose contact with his children. Because, you know, this contact with the children will not actually be consistent with his new life.
Okay.
And also the children, they feel that they need to protect their mother emotionally because they felt they would feel that mom has been, you know, like, with our dad, like, you know, for 30 or 40 or 45 years. And now she's alone, and now he's actually starting a new life and dancing and happy with this new woman. So basically, you know, they really want actually, you know, to protect, you know, their mother.
Sure.
The most important thing, I think, that, you know, children will lose the comfort zone. I don't know if you agree with me or not. Now, a family home, that is having a father and a mother is supposed to be the comfort zone for the children, whether they are old or young. So
absolutely.
Basically, you know, this home, when, you know, like mom and dad are not together anymore, there is no comfort zone for the children or the grandchildren. I mean, you know, even like family occasions, they are gone. I mean, there isn't, like, you know, regular, you know, I would say weddings and showers and stuff like that, because, you know, there will be just, like, you know, disconnected people.
Absolutely. So how do we prevent that?
I would say that the most important thing to prevent that is that that people should understand what marriage, you know, is all about. What commitment is all about. It's not a matter that, you know, that somebody is, like, living with a wife for 35 or 40 years or 45 years, and then all of a sudden, you know, he would discover, oh, I wasn't happy for 45 years, so now I have actually to start a life with somebody who is like, you know, 25 years younger than me or 30 years younger than
sure,
me.
Sure. So what we need is education prior to the marriage. People understand what marriage is, understand what kind of, you know, commitment they have, and honor that for that time.
Exactly, exactly. Mm-hmm. I think that, you know, there should be like some role mm-hmm. for, you know, like religious parties, you know, like to intervene and to, you know, to really to explain to people that yeah. marriage is not actually just like a piece of paper.
Exactly.
You know,
exactly.
As a matter of fact, marriage is a very, very, very strong bond. I mean, you know, like in Islam, it was described as misaq ghaliz.
Yeah,
it means
yeah.
that it is a very strong bond. A bond. It's not supposed to be broken. Just, you know, like after a man, you know, sees like a woman who's ready actually, you know, like to start a relationship with him, although there is like a huge difference, you know, like
sure,
in age.
Sure.
You know what?
You know, we were talking about this yesterday, and we like to see where not only that, you know, religious organizations and social services and all of those organizations in our community conduct these educational classes, if you will, whatever it is, a training, not only before the marriage, but during the marriage as well, where they can have these, you know, confirmation of the marriage, and people kind of understand more and learn more from the experts how they can maintain this marriage.
Exactly. And then, you know, everybody should understand that children, whether they are, you know, adults or young, children are supposed to be our responsibility. I mean, you know,
mm-hmm.
we should
mm-hmm.
not just like, okay, you know, you are not my children anymore. I have another woman right now. I'm planning actually to marry another woman and have kids with her. So I have nothing to do with you. And then the children, whether they are adults or young, they will be actually just like, you know, a target for alcohol abuse, drug
Absolutely.
Abuse,
Absolutely.
Anxiety, depression, all kinds of psychiatric, you know, issues. And even if the children would look like as if they are adjusting and they are successful, still they have like a huge
gap.
Huge pain in their heart.
Yep,
I mean,
yep,
you know,
yep, yep.
like one of my patients told me, and, you know, she is, you know, like, I would say a child of divorce. She said that when I go to other people's houses where, you know, a father is taking care of his kids and of the mother, and he's taking care of all of the details.
Sure.
I just feel, you know, so, so, so sad, and I would say, why it is me?
Yeah. We got 1 minute left, so let's give our listeners how they can get help.
I think that the best thing is to go back to religion. This is the most important thing, you know. I mean, you know, marriage is really like a gold standard in religion.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And, you know, divorce is, it's actually, you know, like, I think it's prevented in some religions, and it is like the worst thing in
sure.
others. Like, you know, in Islam, you know, it is abghad al-halal. It
yeah.
is like, do you know what does it mean, abghad? It means that it is so bad. It is catastrophic. It is devastating. It's not actually promoted by Islam at all.
Absolutely, or any other religion, and we hope that people get the help they need, and we want to thank you for being with us today. This is a very important topic, and I see us, you know, you and us returning to this topic again, hopefully, and I want to thank you again, and happy Easter. This is a wonderful holiday weekend. Thank you so much, Dr. Suwan, as always.
Thank you
always.
So much, Khalil. Thank you so much for inviting
no
me to
problems.
Talk about this.
No problems. We'll be talking about it soon. Thanks again, Dr. Suwan. And I want to thank everyone also for listening. As you know, you've heard today, we talked to about the plight of Syrian refugees in Syria. And also, we talked to Dr. Suwan about the effect of divorce on older children. I want to remind you to be safe this weekend. And again, if there are any issues or any questions or any information you need in regard to buying a home, selling a home, give me a call, 313-819-0101. Have a safe one, everybody. Bye now.
The views expressed on the preceding program may not necessarily be those of the owner or management of WNZK.
WNZK has available a few good hours of airtime for a few good programs to serve their communities. Radio is better than ever in targeting an audience that listens to what you say. Learn more about this exciting radio broadcasting opportunity by calling WNZK Radio at 248-557-3500. Call now.
We are WNZK, Dearborn Heights, Detroit.